Talk about branching. So branching, if loop is also selection and is also branching, so you can call it either of the two. It's called branching because there is possibility of options, yes, no, or possibility of more options, A, B, C, D, and so on. Now, few things also is the same as selection, as you can select any one of these options depending on what the condition is. So, what we can say is, if essentially a number is greater than 10, you know, then do yes or do no if it is less than 10. Or it's also possible that you have grades, which is if A is greater than 90, B is greater than 80, C is greater than 70, D is greater than 60, then you have more choices, correct? So you can actually also select one of these in order to satisfy whichever grade you have actually. So two ways, you know, and that's the selection criteria, that you are selecting A if A is greater than 90, you're selecting B if B is greater than 80, and between 80 and 90 essentially, and then if it's 80 and 70, then you're selecting C, otherwise you're selecting D. Few things also, it is possible that your radius is less than 0, which is actually not possible. So in order to do some kind of data validation, then also you need to deal with that problem, like to make sure your input is correct. Okay, that said, you can do several things here. You can do actually booleans basically, which says true false, then there is, we will talk about the if statement, we'll talk about random few questions, we'll talk about switch statement, which gives the possibility of A, B, C, D, and so on, multiple selections. Okay, moving on. Boolean is a type of operator,
says whether something is true or not. Is 1 greater than 2? No. So this will return us false. So value of B will equal to false. Boolean can only take a value of true or false, nothing else. And condition, either the condition needs to be true or the condition needs to be false, you know. So Java has 6 comparison operators, also known as can be used to compare values. So let's look at those operators. So we have operators. So if so if radius is 5 and then you put radius less, then radius less than 0 means it's not true because radius is more than 0. So the answer will be false. If radius less than equal to, then also it will be false. If radius is greater than equal to, obviously 5 is greater than 0. Greater than equal to true, equal to false. Note, this is 2 equals. So when you do a comparison, it's 2 equals. When you do an assignment, it's 1 equal. So if you have radius equal to 0, then this makes radius value equal to 0. So keep that in mind when you're doing a comparison. So this is a comparison operator and this is a assignment operator. So comparison and assignment. So we use mostly comparison operator, we use comparison operator if we are doing a condition. So equal equal signifies essentially equal, not equal signifies this symbol, and similarly all these signify these. That said, so if we have a simple, so if you want to check for a few things, a program randomly generates two numbers, 1 and 2. So what is, so program has to describe if the answer that the student actually types is correct or wrong. So let's look at that. So how do we would do it? So if we were to do if statement, how would you do if statement? So if the radius is greater than or equal to 0, then calculate the area, otherwise don't. So if radius is greater than or equal to 0, false. If it's not greater than or equal to 0, you skip the step. So you skip this step of calculating the area. But if it's true, that means radius is positive value, then you actually calculate the area. So it goes, so these brackets signify if this value is true, then it will go in to this piece to calculate the answer using this code. Similarly, what we say is if the expression, so the expression here is true, then it goes into this bracket, you know, this piece of code. Otherwise, it skips that piece of code. This signifies that relationship, and the example is actually here. That means if radius is greater than 0, this value is going to be true. And if it's true, then it calculates area equal to radius, you know, and then println the area. And that. But if the value is false, then it'll skip it and not calculate it. That said, there are two ways of doing this. So if, essentially, basically, one, you have to be, it has to be a bracket around, so keep that in mind. Plus, whatever goes in here is what is going to be worked on when this value is true. So if, or it could be done in another way, where this could be represented as just the line under it. So you can have the if statement and you can have a line which is what needs to be executed after that if. If this is false, it'll skip this line. So it'll come directly here and skip this line. Okay? That said, so write a program that prompts essentially a user to enter an index. So there you go. So prompts if user to enter. So if the Boolean expression is true, then we go this path and we execute this set of statements. And if it is false, then it'll execute this set of statements. So this guy, the false case, this guy, the true case. Okay? So if it's true, it takes this path. If it's false, then it takes this path. It does different events. So if radius is greater than 0, it will calculate the area in this case. And if radius is less than 0, it will say the input is not right. So this is called data validation. So this is telling you your data validate is not validate. So there are several examples of something like this. Is I'm measuring somebody's height and somebody enters minus 7.3 inches for height or 7.3 feet. Height negative is not possible. So things like that you have to check and see. That's one more example. Similarly, you can have grading. So you can do grading in this way. So you can say if A is greater than or equal to 90, then it's A. Else if grade is 80, then it's B. 70, C, D or F. So you can actually represent it the same way. What happens is if the condition is true, it'll execute this line. Otherwise, it'll jump onto here. And then it'll execute this line. If this condition is true, it'll execute this line. Otherwise, it'll jump onto the next one. Keep in mind, if everything fails, it'll give that person F. So assuming you have negative 100, everything will fail. That is F, basically. If you have negative 50, still you will have an F. Negative 30, you'll still have an F. 45, you'll still have an F. But if it's greater than 60, then you have a D. Otherwise, you have an F. No E. Similarly, so this is way to analyze it. So if greater than A, it'll be grade A. If greater than B, grade B. Greater than C, you know, greater than 70, grade C, D, E. And it executes the next thing after that. So this route will only come when it is true. Greater than equal to 90, system out A. If greater than equal to 80, system out B. Greater than equal to 70, system out C. Greater than equal to 60, system out D, and then F. Essentially, same way of writing it. So if the condition is false, then it goes here. If this is also false, then it goes here. If this is also false, then it goes here, which is the default, basically. And if everything fails, it goes and gives you an F. Similarly, see, if this condition is false, it'll give you B. If this condition is false, it'll give you C. If this condition is true, it'll go in. If this condition was true, it will go in here. Otherwise, it will execute this. Only if the condition is true, then only it will give you. So suppose the score is 70. So 70, so if you go back, 70 is less than 90. That means this is false. It goes to this. Then this is also false. Then it goes to this. And score is equal to 70. That means this condition becomes true. That means it will execute this statement. And it will output grade equal to C. Similarly, grade C. And it will exit the statement after that. Keeping that in mind. Okay, few other things. You see, note, else clause also matches the most trees. So what happens is, if you do an if and do another if after that, that means this, it will go into the next if once this is true. Once this is true, it will go in here and then it will output. Else it will give you, you know, B. Yeah, this is better way indentation. The reason why this is indentation is then these things line up and you know that this is part of this if statement. Okay? It's easy to debug if it's correctly lined up. So if there is an if, the else should match that if. Now, if there was an if and there was an else here, so you could actually do the else for this should match here. Basically, the indentation should match so that you know this else is matching this if. So the next thing, to force else statement clause to match, so you can also do a bracket to make sure that it is contained. That means this else is matching this if, and there is no else for this if. This bracket, so this piece becomes code that actually is essentially, which will work if I is greater than j. If I is not greater than j, then it will work with this code. It will print b at that point. Otherwise, it will go in and check. If I is also greater than k, then it will print a. Otherwise, it will not print anything. It will just come out from here. Now, another thing, the common errors in this is, if you have an if, you do not write a semicolon at the end of it. That terminates this statement and it won't go into this guy. So it will not do this guy, not execute this. So it will not execute this. It's a hard to find mistake. A lot of you make this mistake. So keep in mind about that. So another thing, so this basically tells you if a number is even. That means number, so if you have number percentage 2 equal to 0, this is even. Note, double equals. Number percentage 3 equal to 0 means divisible by 3. Number percent 4 equal to 0 divisible by 4. If it's not equal to 0, that means if I say number not equal to number percentage 4 not equal to 0, that means it is not divisible by 4. There you go. So this is also the same as this. Because you say even is equal to number, so you are actually saying that this, whatever the value is in here, is fed into even, essentially. So this is one way of writing it. It says number, so this gets evaluated first, and it returns as true if the number is even. If the number is even, then this is true. If this is false, then even is equal to false. This is another way of doing it. Similarly, even equal to true is also the same as even, because if that value is true, then this value inside will be true. If that value is false, this value inside will be false. So if if, so even is equal to true, and if even is equal to false, this bracket value will be false, and then accordingly it'll work. So we're talking about numbers that are greater than each other, and if student talks about, so we talk about, so BMI less than 18.5, then BMI between 18.5 and, so we are measuring of health on weight. It can be calculated by taking your weight in kilograms and dividing by the height in meters. The interpretation of BMI for people 16 years old or is follow. So if somebody is underweight, BMI is less than 18.5. If somebody is normal, it is between 25 and 18.5. If somebody is overweight, then it's between 25 and 30. If somebody is obese, then it's between 30. It's less than, it's BMI is, should be greater than or equal to 30. Then it's obese. So there's a correction here. That said, you see, so another problem essentially is tax rate. So 10% and income should actually, so if you're filing tax rate, if your tax rate is 10%, then your income should be in certain values. If your tax rate is 15%, your income should be in between something. Similarly, so this you can calculate by using if. So status 0 computes, so status 1 qualifying widower, 2, 3, so basically it allows you, and otherwise if it's not 1, 2, 3, that means no status available. So status 0 is this guy, 1, 2, 3, so you can actually do status 0, 1, 2, 3, so you can do 0, 1, 2, 3. And then accordingly, so 0, 1, 2, 3 basically tells you if it's single, qualified, joined separately, or head of household. Okay? That tells you 1, 2, 3, 4. So that basically, so for single filers, so you have single filers. They have single filers, which is 0. So if you look, this is single filers, 0. Married is basically 1, so you know, to compute tax accordingly. So there is nothing as 4, so no status available there. So logical operators, so there is something as not, there is something as and, or exclusive or. Okay, so that's logical exclusion, logical disjunction, logical conjunction, logic. So few logical operators that you can use in if. That's it. If, so assuming the age is 24 and weight is 140, age greater than 18, so not greater than 18 means less than 18, greater than 18 means true year and false year. So this is, if somebody is 24, then age is greater than 18, so this is 24, is greater than 18, that means this inside the bracket will be true and not true will be false. Similarly, if ages is greater than 18, it will be true. Okay, similarly, weight is equal to 150, so I have weight 140. 140 is not equal to 150, so this is basically false, and not false is true. So weight is equal to 150, so 150 is equal to 150, and weight is false essentially, so 150 equal to 150, and then what happens is 150 is equal to 150, and then 150 essentially is 150, and that said, if those two are equal, then this is true, essentially. So this is called the truth table for an operator. Similarly, you can have actually, if you do AND. So how it works is AND.
So let's look at the truth tables. So there are truth tables, there are few truth tables. Truth table actually is basically value of A and value of B. If value of A is false, value of B is false, then the truth table says it's false basically. Like A and B will be false. In this case, P1 and P2 will be false. So few other things, like that means that if I am saying, okay, age less than equal to 18, current age is 24. Is 24 less than equal to 18? It is not. So this is false. And is weight less than 140? It is not. It is equal to 140. So this is also false. What does that mean? Two falses will give you false. So the combination of this statement will be false. Okay? Both conditions are false. It's false. True. Another thing. If the first one's false, the second one's true. If either one of them is false, the answer will be false. So true, false, that means one is false, that means it is false when you do an AND. So age is greater than 18, which is true, because 24 is greater than 18, and weight is greater than 140, which is because weight is 140. So basically it's not greater. So this is false. And what does that mean? True and false is basically false. So the answer for this whole expression will be false. The next thing, true, true gives true. That means this and this, then only the condition is going to be true. So age is greater than 24 is greater than 18, which is true. Weight is greater than equal to, so 140 is equal to 140. So this is also so true. True and true will give you true according to this. True and true gives you true. So in order for AND to work, either both need to be true in order for it to be true. Either one of the false or both are false, the answer is false. Similarly, or. So if either one of them is true, the answer is true. So if both are false, obviously it's false. So either one of them is true. Both are true, so still true. So let's see, age greater than 34. So 24 is not greater than, so this is false. Weight less than equal to, so this is true, because 140 is equal to 140. So either one of them is true, so the answer is true. Similarly, age greater than 14, so 24 greater than 14, this is true. Weight greater than, this is false, okay? Then your answer is true still, because one of them is true. So because age is greater than true. Similarly, if both are true, the answer is still true. So if you want to say, if the candidate is age 24 and is 140, then we use the AND statement. But if it says the candidate is greater than 440 or the weight is 140, you know, then we use the OR operator. Similarly, there is another operator, the UP. So the exclusive basically. So that means either one of them can be true. So if both are false, the answer is false. If age is greater than 34, it is true. Weight is greater than false. So because age is not greater than 34, so this is false, and two false, so the answer is false basically. It should be exclusive, so that means only one can be true. So age is greater than 34 is false, but weight is equal to 140, so this is true, because 140 is equal to 140, and that the condition says either one of them, so the answer is true, because if either one of them is true, the answer is true. Similarly, if age is greater than this is true, weight, it's false because it's equal to, and this will become true because age is greater than 14 and weight is not equal to 140. So one of them is true, so the answer final is true. Similarly, if both are true, then it's not either being true, so the answer is actually false. Like assuming if we had age greater than 14 and weight greater than equal to 140, in that case the answer for this is going to be false, because this is true, both trues give a false, because age is greater than 14 and you know this, so you have this basically, or weight is equal to 140, so the answer finally becomes false. That said, you can check a number of things using this. So a program that whether a number is divisible by 2 and 3, whether a number is divisible by 2 or 3, whether a number is divisible by 2 or 3 but not both, three conditions. So this becomes AND, this becomes OR, and this becomes exclusive OR. So here you go. So examples, so this means if a number is divisible by 2, this will be true. If a number is divisible by 3, this will be true. So the answer will finally be true. In this case, the number is divisible by true, this is true, or this is A or B. So the answer is going to be true. And this is similarly, if this is true and if this is false, the answer is true because it's divisible by one or the other. If this is false, this is true, the answer is still true because it's divisible by 3 and not by 2. Now, if it's divisible by 3 and 2, so you have both trues, then the answer is false because the question asks either one of them but not both. So similarly, there is a single OR operator and a single AND operator, which you can actually check. Now, that said, the single AND operator. If x is 1, what is the value after this expression? So x is greater than, so depends on x here. So let's talk about the single AND and this single OR. So the single AND is very, the thing is that there is something called efficient way of doing things and there is something that is basically slightly inefficient, or I would say it is. So single AND will calculate this guy and this guy both, and only after that will give you an answer. So assuming this is true, the answer is true, it's the AND basically, but it will calculate both. In the case of double AND, it will calculate the first one, and if the first one's false, and you know, that means AND the next one, whatever the value may be, but it still will be false. So it does not end up calculating this guy. Similar case, you know, one or the other, you know, because it, even though one of them is false, it doesn't need the answer. If this was true, this side was true, then it needs to calculate this side in order to make sure that this is not false. But if the first one's false, it doesn't matter whether the second one's true or false. There you go, that's the single operator, okay. So another problem that you actually see is basically calculating a leap year. So how do you do? Something is divisible by 4, this tells you it is divisible by 4, and the year by 100 is not equal to 0, and or the year is not 400 basically is equal to 0. So how does it say? So in program you enter a year, if it's a leap year it's divisible by 4 but not 100, or it is divisible by 400. So what does this say? If this is true and it's not 100 true, or if this is true, so if these two are true, then this will be true. No matter if this is false or not, it doesn't matter. If this is false and this is true, the OR will make it true because either one of them has to be true in OR. There you go. So lottery is pretty similar. So let's look at switch statements. So switch statement actually gives you the ability to have more than one choices. So if you want a choice A, B, C, D, E, F, G, you can actually make cases for each one of them. And the code is much cleaner because you don't need that many things. And then you have a final choice which is called default. That means the last choice basically, which is default, which says okay, if it is not 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 3, anything else, it will exit basically. So what is this saying? So it says compute taxes for households, so compute taxes for married people, compute taxes for, otherwise it says it's not a valid number. So this is essentially the value that actually goes in here to check. So assuming it was similarly, so you would do case A, case B for these guys, and so on. So this is how the case works in flowchart. So break means it will actually not continue doing the case and it will bypass everything else. So status is 0, it computes the tax, break statement allows it to bypass everything and go. If you do not put break, it will go into the next case essentially and check for next case. So you have to put break after every case. If status is 1, yes, then you are qualifying as a widower. Status 2, you are qualifying as married filing separately. Status is 3, you compute tax for household. Status is 4, status is 4 or above, you know, it's a default action. A negative number is a default action. So if none of these catch your case, this will catch your case and then it will come out. So how do we write it? Switch, basically this is the value, this is the expression that you are trying to do, and whatever the expression value is here. So switch basically is the value that goes in here. Break is optional, but it needs to be at the end of it. If you can do multiple cases, so if you want to do, say, assuming A, B and C give the same value or have to run the state set statements, you can say case A, case B, case C, and then whatever code you need essentially in here, and then a break after that. So you can do that. So then what happens is, if the value of the expression is A, B or C, then it will do the same thing and then it will exit, you know, and then you can have case D and do something with a break, and then case E, we do something with a break basically. So how it actually works is A, B, C will do the same thing and then break, and then if you do not put a break, it goes into the next code, it checks for this guy. Okay, so it's good to put a break, you know. It is optional, but it should be used in case if you want to terminate the remainder of the switch. So if you want to terminate and get out of the switch statement, then you have to use break. So, you know, day, so assuming you want to do day, for case 1, 2, 3, 4, you don't want to do anything. Case 5, you want to do something, you know, so there you go. So what, or case 0, you want to do something. So let's see, suppose the day is 2, it matches case 2, there is nothing, it will fall through to case 3, you know, and then it will fall through to case 4, and then it will fall through to case 5 basically. So all these cases it will fall through all of these. So that means any of these values will give you, it is a weekday, and then it will break. If it's 0, then it's Sunday, and 6, it's Saturday. So that means 0 or 6, it will fall through to weekend essentially. So how it works is, you enter the day here, it checks for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and any of these are true, then it will put its weekday. It checks for 0 and 6, any of that is true, then it puts weekend, and then it exits after that, because there is no code after that, it exits after that. Any other number, it will exit, it will just fall through, because there is no default, so that's why it will fall through. Similarly, at the end of it, it will encounter break and it gets out of the loop. So exit statement, it gets out. So if you want to do the Chinese zodiac thing, so you know, you want to put, so which year, and it tells you which of them to take, so you can have a case. So what you can do, you can say percentage by year, if it's equal to 0, then you put monkey, 1 you put rooster, 2 you put dog, 3 you put pig, and so on. Essentially, and so it will be case 0, you can out system out monkey, and then you do break. Then case 1, you can do system out rooster, then do a break. Then case 2, go on 3, 4, 5, and then, you know, and then any other number, and this is going to be in your case statement. So switch, then you do here, percentage 12. So whatever the answer is here is fed into the case statement. So if 0, then goes to case 0. If 1, goes to case 1. Case 2, it's 2. So conditions, expression. So if x is greater than 0, so equivalent to, so that's another way of writing if. So y is equal to, if x is greater than 0, then value is 1, else the value is minus 1. So this is the then value, and this is the else value. Basically, so the Boolean expression, question mark, says if this is the expression, then this guy, else this guy. So you have, so that's one thing, conditional operators. So, so if this is equal to 0, then it's even. You can also say the same thing can be written here, saying that if, so this is, if num is 0, then num is even, else num is odd. You know, that way you don't need to do such a big if thing. For small things, you can easily use this kind of terminology. So Boolean expression, expression 1, expression 2. Similarly, you can, there is also, you know, unary operators, all these. So we looked at all of these actually. So associate precedence. So parenthesis is evaluated first. Parenthesis can be nested, in which case the expression of the enum parenthesis is executed first. And operators with the same parenthesis are next to each other. They are determined the order of evaluation. All binary operators except assignment operators are left associative. So A plus B minus C minus D is basically this guy, and you can add basically. Or is the same as this guy minus T. There you go. This actually shows this gets executed first, then the multiplication, then the second multiplication, then the addition, then this guy subtraction, and then the evaluation, then the greater than sign. So that's the order in which the rules actually go. So evaluation order. So debugging. Debugging is important because debugging actually allows you to step through your code. If it's a large complex problem, the more effective approach is debugging is to use a debugger utility. There is a separate video which allows you to execute a statement one at a time, stepping over a method. So if you have a method, you can set breakpoints where you can stop and see values. You can display variable values. You can display the call stack or the order in which what functions have been put in there. You can modify variables if you want to check and debug. So debugging in Eclipse, there is a video for debugging in Eclipse. You can actually look at that. That's it.